Well, good morning. I know we have not as many people here this morning, but I thought, and it's 10:03, so let's try again. Good morning.
Good morning.
Good. I thought I was here by myself this morning. Welcome to Trinity. We're excited to have you here this morning as we come and bring praises to our Lord, whether you are here joining us in person or joining us online. We're just excited to have you here this morning. We believe that God is here at work amongst us and that you get to participate in what God is doing in this next hour together. I want to make a quick note for those who are watching us via Facebook Live this morning. Our online check-in link is under construction, but if you just put your name in the chat, let us know that you're here. A lot of you do anyway. That can suffice for your check-in this morning. But we're excited about all that God is doing among us. We have been working through the book of Acts really since last fall, and we're kind of in the final home stretch. We'll wrap up at the end of July. But we're continuing to learn life lessons from Paul as he sought to follow Jesus and to share God's message of salvation throughout the world. And so with that, we are invited for this opportunity to come together to join our hearts in worship. And our first opportunity each week is the call to worship. So I invite you to stand as you're able and join in the call to worship this morning. You're going to see your part up on the screen in yellow. I know sometimes there's confusion about when do I go. When you see yellow, that's a chance for you to participate and join your voice. So let's join in this call to worship rooted in Luke chapter 5. The invitation is given to every person by Jesus Christ. Come to me, follow me, be my disciples.
We come to this place, to this time, at the invitation of Jesus Christ.
In the name of Christ.
We accept the invitation to discipleship.
In the name of Christ.
As his disciples, we worship and praise God.
In the midst of a world where cruelty abounds. In the midst of despair that threatens to swallow up whole lives and whole people.
We proclaim the God of hope.
In the midst of indifference and apathy.
We proclaim the God of love.
So come, let us worship together and share our witness of God's living presence in the world. So now we'll join our hearts together in worship by singing hymn number 433. My hope is built on nothing less.
Jesus' blood and righteousness. I dare not trust the sweetest frame, but wholly lean on Jesus' name. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. All other ground is sinking sand. When darkness veils his lovely face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil. On Christ the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. Stand before the throne.
Amen. You may be seated. Father, that is our heart's desire this morning, that you alone would be our vision. That God, we would see the world through your eyes, that we would embrace our brothers and sisters with your heart, with your love, with your compassion, with your mercy, God. We acknowledge, Lord, that we live in a world that's very dark. There's a lot of things that we experience that could make us discouraged. So you call us to fix our eyes on you, Lord, the author and the perfecter of our faith. So God, help us to focus in on you and you alone, to keep our focus clear as we seek to follow you and to become more like you each day. Thank you, Lord, for this opportunity that we have each week to come together as a family, as a community, to be encouraged so that we may be a blessing to all the peoples of the earth. So, Lord, move in us this morning that we might become more like you. We pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Good morning again. Morning. We're glad you're all here. Nice small crowd. Very intimate crowd. I offer you a warm welcome. If you're visiting for the first time, we ask that you fill out the Connect card in the pew and drop it in the box at the back of the church. The rest of you can please pass the black book through the row. And again, just a reminder, those of you that might have tuned in late, our website is down. If you could check in online on the Facebook, just put your name in there or say a hello, and then we'll see that you're worshiping with us today. All right, we have some slides with some announcements. I don't know if we can cue up some of the, there it is. Okay, Bible study. I might be out of order, so I have to check. Again, we're back in session 1 and 6:30 for Bible study. Hope to see you there this Wednesday. We also have Almost Home collection of pastaroni and rice-a-roni, the cups, to make it a little bit easier. You just have to add some water and heat them up. So there will be a box in the front for that. Yep, the baseball game is Tuesday. Who signed up? Oh, We got to see some more hands out there. Yeah, today's the day to sign up. It's Cheap Tuesday. I don't know if that's what it's called, but it's like $3 for a ticket. Hot dogs are like $2. So we had a really nice time. We've gone in the past a few years back, but we went last year. It was a good time, a lot of fun, just hanging out, watching some baseball. There's nothing better in the summer than that. So, oh, we're combining with Crosswinds Church, which is Tom's brother's church, so we would like to see, that'd be great to have a nice crowd there. I don't know the weather, if it's going to be super hot or cool, I don't know. It doesn't matter, it's going to be nice. So please try to come and attend that. We have just August 2nd coming up, put it on your calendar, I don't think that's up there, but dessert only on a Friday night. We're going to kind of go with a Friday theme. We had the fireworks week ago. I wasn't here last Sunday, but that was a big event. There were lots of people here, but please, August 2nd, put that in your calendar. All right. Jesus stands before us offering us his peace. By exchanging the peace with one another, it should be a reminder that we are not alone, that we worship in community with each other. Christ gathered disciples around himself, and now he calls us into community as well. Please rise and share a sign of God's peace with each other.
Not quite. There we go. Hey, maybe that's the trick. Just have the mic not work, and then people start sitting down, and then by the time it works, everybody's sitting. That's, See, the tech booth gets a bad rap sometimes, but there is a method behind the madness, and we do appreciate everybody that's up there each week, and I will just say thank you so much, all of you who are up there. I will say this. Summer, as you might have noticed, sometimes we have a bit of a skeleton crew here at Trinity, and so often there are many people doing many different jobs. If you are wanting to get involved, whether it be in the tech ministry, whether it be greeting, whether it be just helping in some different areas, man, we'd love your help. We'd love to have more faces reading scripture, different people being involved. And so even we, you know, we were in there this morning filling communion cups, just helping Diana out in there. And so however you can lend a hand. But I will say this. Last Monday night was Almost Home's first dinner in the house. And it was beautiful. And what was really beautiful about it to me is that there were random Trinity people that just showed up and lended a hand in different ways. And that is always welcomed. If you're ever like, I want to see what this Almost Home is all about, I want to come and volunteer. I mean, I know Jamie would appreciate maybe a little bit of a heads up if there's like 20 people showing up. But yeah, we would love for you to come, and I will just say this, hospitality is a ministry. Let me say that again. Hospitality is a ministry. Offering a smile and offering a warm welcome is a huge ministry. So you might say, I don't know how to cook anything. I'm not sure how to do some of these different things, but if you can smile and say, hello, what's your name? That's a huge ministry. So I want to just throw that out, that there are opportunities to be involved, even this summer, even then when we're kind of at a little slower pace. There's always an opportunity, even Sunday mornings, during that passing of the peace. That passing of the peace time is gold, because it's an opportunity to make someone feel like they matter, like they welcome, especially if you remember their name, which I'm not always the best at, but if you can remember their name, that's huge. And so as we continue to worship this morning during our offertory time, we're going to sing In Christ Alone. And this morning, the idea is focusing on Jesus, keeping our eyes fixed on Jesus. And so as we sing In Christ Alone, I want to just have you think about, how am I keeping my eyes fixed on Jesus? How am I focused in on what God is doing? How am I keeping myself from being distracted from what God would have me do, how he'd have me serve, how he'd have me spend my time? So with that being said, I want to invite you to stand once more as we sing In Christ Alone.
Till he returns or calls. calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I'll stand. Here in the power of Christ we stand. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise Him,
all creatures here below. Praise Him above, ye heavenly hosts. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost. Amen.
You may be seated. Father God, this morning, we're reminded that, Lord, you are our only strength, our only hope, our only sure foundation, God. God, we admit and we acknowledge that we are seduced and distracted into relying on all sorts of other things, including ourselves. So often when the going gets tough, Lord, we just hold on tighter. We want to have this control. We want to manipulate our surroundings and our circumstances. But God, you continually remind us that your yoke is easy and your burden is light, Lord. And you have offered to carry our burdens for us. To carry us, Lord, when we don't think we can take another step, Lord, you step in to let us know that you are with us and that you will never leave us and you'll never forsake us. And God, as I'm praying this morning, I'm well aware there are many among us and many watching online that live with a great deal of uncertainty. Not knowing what tomorrow will bring, not knowing maybe what this afternoon will bring, not knowing about that job, not knowing if that promotion is going to come through, not knowing if they can pay next month's rent, not knowing, God, how this relationship is going to work out, not knowing so many things. So that, Lord, is when we are reminded to put it in your hands, to allow you, Lord, to carry our burdens. And so, God, we need the power of your Holy Spirit to let go of those things that we want to control, to allow you, Lord, to reign in our lives. And so to do that, Lord, we keep our eyes fixed on your Son, Jesus, whose prayer begins with, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen."
Today's scripture reading comes from Acts 25, verses 1 through 12. 3 days after arriving in the province, Festus went up from Caesarea to Jerusalem, where the chief priests and the Jewish leaders appeared before him and presented the charges against Paul. They requested Festus as a favor to them to have Paul transferred to Jerusalem, for they were preparing an ambush to kill him along the way. Festus answered, "Paul is being held at Caesarea, and I myself am going there soon. Let some of your leaders come with me, and if the man has done anything wrong, they can press charges against him there." After spending 8 or 10 days with them, Festus went down to Caesarea. The next day, he convened to the court and ordered that Paul be brought before him. When Paul came in, the Jews who had come down from Jerusalem stood around him. They brought many serious charges against him, but they could not prove them. Then Paul made his defense. "I have done nothing wrong against the Jewish law or against the temple or against Caesar." Festus, wishing to do the Jews a favor, said to Paul, "Are you willing to go to Jerusalem and stand trial before me there on these charges?" Paul answered, "I am now standing before Caesar's court where I ought to be tried. I have not done anything wrong to the Jews, as you yourself know very well. If, however, I am guilty of doing anything deserving death, I do not refuse to die. But if the charges brought against me by those Jews are not true, no one has the right to hand me over to them. I appeal to Caesar. After Festus had conferred with his council, he declared, "You have appealed to Caesar. To Caesar you will go." This is the word of the Lord.
Sorry, turned my microphone on. That was on me. We've been following Paul's journeys for several months now. And it just seems like Paul gets into difficult situation after difficult situation over and over and over again. And it raises the question, what keeps Paul going? Like, how does one person just keep going and keep persevering during all these circumstances? And if you haven't been with us for the whole time, let me just get us all up to speed about what Paul has been through just recently leading up to this moment. So Paul, let's see. Even when he was on his way to Jerusalem, he had his friends warning him, "Paul, don't go. Don't go. Something terrible is going to happen to you." And he said, "I've got to go. I've got to go." He felt a calling. God was calling him to go down to Jerusalem. So he's like, "I got to be faithful to God." Even though his friends were saying, "Don't go, don't go." And they were begging him, "Don't go." Still goes. What happens once he gets to Jerusalem? He gets to Jerusalem. And the leadership in the Jerusalem church says, "Well, Paul, it's good to see you. But not everybody's real excited about what you're doing. That's ministry to the Gentiles. And so why don't you go do this and this and this, and that should sort of smooth things over with the other Jews, and then everything will be great." Well, didn't quite work out that way. Matter of fact, there's a group of Jews that see him with a Greek, and they're furious. They grab hold of him. They just about tear him apart. One of the Roman commanders sees him, pulls him into a fortress. What is going on? He shares his story, at which they try to tear him apart again, so they got to put him in protective custody. They pull him into a room, and they say, "Let's get to the bottom of this." And the way a Roman knows how to get to the bottom of anything is, "I'm going to beat a confession out of him." So they prep him to get flogged, to get whipped, the same way that Jesus got whipped. And so as they are preparing him, they've got him chained up to this pole, they're about ready to whip him, he goes, "Hey, wait a minute, is this how you treat all of the Roman citizens?" And they go, because it's illegal to beat a confession out of a Roman citizen. And so then they're like, "Well, let's have another meeting. Let's figure this out." Paul again shares a story. He gets one sentence out. He gets beat across the face. And then after that, you would think, okay, that's bad enough. Well, while he's being held in protective custody, his nephew gets wind of a plot to assassinate him. There are 40 men who have taken a vow. "We will not eat or drink anything until we have killed Paul." And so Roman commander gets wind of this. He takes about 400 troops, moves him up to Caesarea, again, to keep him in protective custody, to keep him safe. And you would think, okay, well, maybe now we're getting somewhere. But what happens is more and more legalities, more and more waiting, and Paul is stuck. So what keeps him going? Well, right in the middle of his moment of despair, right in the middle of his moment of challenge, of waiting, in chapter 23, verse 11, Jesus says to Paul, "Take courage. As you have testified about me in Jerusalem, so you must also testify in Rome." So he promises him, "Paul, you're going to get to Rome." Now, he doesn't say how he's going to get to Rome. He doesn't say when he's going to get to Rome. He doesn't tell him what he's going to have to go through to get there. He doesn't promise him smooth sailing, but he says, "But you're going to get there. So be encouraged." You might say, okay, great. Paul's going to get, you know, shortly he's going to get to go to Rome, until you look at what happens at the end of chapter 24. Chapter 24, verse 27, it says, "One, 2 years had passed. Felix was succeeded by Porcius Festus. Because Felix wanted to grant a favor to the Jews, he left Paul in prison." So, you know, not to get into a ton of historical context, but essentially what history would tell us about Felix is that Felix was not a great guy. He was pretty corrupt, matter of fact, and he ruled in a very cruel manner. And you know what? As far as Roman officials were concerned, all they want to do is keep the peace and keep the taxes coming. That's all they really care about. And so Paul, he doesn't seem to have done anything wrong, but he kind of causes an uproar, so they just sort of put him away. They put him away in custody, and Felix says, even though he visits him and he talks to him, eventually he kind of just forgets about him. And can you imagine? Can you imagine a guy like Paul, who he is all about going out to this place and that place and sharing the gospel, sharing the message of hope of the resurrection of Jesus Christ? This is what gets Paul up in the morning, and he is stuck. Can't do any of that. He can maybe witness to a prison guard. He might witness to somebody who is in the same facility, but he's totally restricted from being able to go out and about and do this mission, this assignment that God has called him to. So he's stuck. So what does he do? He keeps facing forward. Paul keeps facing forward towards God's promise. Even though he doesn't appreciate his circumstances, he doesn't appreciate his situation, he doesn't enjoy what's happening, he has this hope. We sung about hope a few times this morning. He has this hope. He's like, God told me this. And I know God to be a faithful God. I know God to be a trustworthy God. So even though my circumstances tell me that I've been left and forgotten about, I'm going to choose to face forward. I'm going to choose to focus on what God has promised me and not focus on these other things. And then we have this new person. So Felix sort of lets him rot just to kind of appease the Jewish constituency and sort of keep the peace. But then this new guy, Festus, he comes on the scene, chapter 25, verse 1. He's a little different. It says, 3 days after arriving in the province, Festus went up from Caesarea to Jerusalem. So it doesn't take him any time at all. He's on the job for 3 days. Let me go down to Jerusalem. Let me meet some of my constituents. Let me find out what's going on. Festus is a different kind of leader. I'm not saying he's perfect. Most of the Roman leaders had significant issues, but Festus is trying to do his job. So he goes down to Jerusalem to check in with the chief priests, the Jewish leaders. And when they go, he meets with some of his constituency, because how it works is typically Festus is in charge, right? He's the governor of this entire area of Palestine, but he utilized local leadership to kind of keep everybody in their place. And so it was a good idea for him to sort of get these folks on his side. And when he goes down to meet these chief priests and the leaders, they're still mad about Paul. 2 years later, they still haven't given it up. There is a deep distrust, a deep hatred, a deep desire to get rid of Paul. Matter of fact, it says in verse 3 that they want to have Paul transferred back to Jerusalem because they want to ambush him. They want to rid Paul from the earth. This is not just an annoyance now. This is not just something where it's like, oh, they want to get rid of Paul. So this means he's got an ongoing threat on his life. So Festus listens and sort of democratically, sort of politically says, well, he's in Caesarea, which is about 60 miles away from Jerusalem. He's in Caesarea. I'm going there soon. Why don't you come with me? And if he's done anything wrong, you can press charges. So now here's another. This thing has been drug out for months and years. I mean, Paul has met before, you know, trial before trial before trial. I'm sure he's just exhausted by this whole thing. But Festus says, well, can we get this thing off his docket? I mean, he's taken his office, he's taken this new job, and he's got this Paul guy. Well, why didn't Felix take care of it? Well, Felix didn't want to take care of it. Now it's Festus's problem. He's like, well, let's resolve this thing. Let's get it figured out. And in the midst of yet another round of accusations, and those of us who have been reading through, we know these accusations are not true. They're not based in fact, and Paul knows this so well, and actually the people accusing him know this as well, but they just don't like Paul. They want to get rid of Paul. So as Paul's in this situation, it reminds me of something he wrote in Romans chapter 5, verses 3 through 5. Paul wrote this. It said, not only so, but we also glory in our sufferings, because we know that suffering produces perseverance, perseverance character, and character hope. And hope does not put us to shame, because God's love has been poured out into our hearts through the Holy Spirit who has been given to us. Now, I know that passage has been put on artwork and posters, and you know, people have it up in their homes. And taken in a vacuum, you could say, well, that sounds really good, but glory in our sufferings? Really? I don't like to suffer. I don't know about you, but I don't enjoy pain and suffering and anguish and depression and all these different things. But Paul knows that what he's going through has a purpose. That God is working. I'm not saying that God is causing his suffering. And I think sometimes when we go through the life challenges that we faced, oftentimes we'll default to, why is God doing this to me? And I would answer, I don't think God is doing that to you. I think that's circumstances and people and personality and relationships and the broken nature of our world causes suffering. But I also know this, that God doesn't waste anything. That God is always at work to make us more like him. And so in the middle of a situation, Paul learns perseverance. And through his perseverance, it develops his character, and through his character, hope. Now, what verse 5 says, I think, is really important. Because if this is not real, if this is just some book that somebody wrote at some point and just pretended to be truth, if the God that we have been singing to and worshiping this morning is just a figment of our imagination, then Paul is a fool. And we're all fools too. But if this is true, if the God that we worship is actually real, is actually listening when we sing, is actually listening when we pray, is actually present with us when we go through all that we go through, then we can have hope. Hope isn't just an idea, isn't just some philosophical thing that we hold on to. It's not just a nice quote. Hope is oxygen. Hope is God at work, that God is at work today, and that God is one day going to make all things new when he comes again. When Jesus comes again, and we talked about it in Be Thou My Vision, right? High King of Heaven, your victory won. Well, the victory was already won on the cross once. And that victory is going to be fully in evidence when Jesus comes back. But I want to tell you this, Jesus sits on the throne today. Jesus sits on the throne today, and I think sometimes that's hard to believe. Again, because we open up our newspaper, or we turn on the news, or we walk through our neighborhoods and go like, man, if Jesus is on the throne, what is he doing? Well, if you remember, what he's doing is he's calling us. The followers of Christ in Acts chapter 1, remember what Jesus says as he ascends into heaven. You will be my witnesses. People will see your lives, how you behave and what you say, and hopefully they see me. We are to be representatives. Matter of fact, this church and all of the churches that follow Jesus are designed to be embassies of the kingdom of God. You, in a sense, are a diplomat for Jesus. Might say, I don't know if I like that. That sounds like a lot of pressure. But think about who Jesus called. When Jesus called the disciples, he didn't call the A-team. He didn't call the ones with the best education or the most degrees. Matter of fact, he chose a bunch of dropouts and screw-ups to be his representatives. You look at Peter as a shining example of a guy who can't get out of his own way. But he's the rock. Jesus said, I call you Peter, and on this rock I will build my church. Now, we look at ourselves and say, there's no way that Jesus would say that about me. And I'd say, well, I think you're underestimating the power of the Holy Spirit. Because I look around the room this morning and I think about those who are watching online. And I know, I don't just wonder, I actually know, because I've been here long enough to see so many of you in action, that you are actually doing it. You are actually being the hands and feet of Jesus in many different ways on an ongoing basis. That is what we are called to. So in the midst of his adversity then, Paul understands hope and understands that while adversity tests our character and challenges our focus, we still are children of God. God has still called us. God has still invited us. No matter who you are, no matter where you've been, if you open your hands up and say, yes, Lord, here am I, send me into whatever you want me to do. That adversity is going to come, but it's a refining process. It's a refining process. I'm not saying it's always a pleasant process. I don't wake up in the morning and say, Lord, can you just send me some adversity? I would love that. That would be great. And by the way, I was talking with somebody in the last couple weeks. Somebody said, I've been praying for patience. I said, oh boy. Because when you pray for patience, it isn't like God's like, alakazam, you have patience. God usually says, all right, I'm going to give you some opportunities to be patient. So if you're praying for patience, I'm going to bet that the traffic is going to be worse for you. I'm going to bet that the technology in your house is not going to work the way it's supposed to. I'm going to bet there's going to be some people in your life that are going to be aggravating and annoying, because this is part of the process. It's part of the refining process. That God uses often this adversity to refine our character, to challenge our focus. And if you look at verse 6, after spending 8 or 10 days with them, Festus went down to Caesarea. The next day, he convened the court and ordered that Paul be brought before him. So here we go. Here we go again. Paul comes in verse 7. The Jews who had come down from Jerusalem stood around him. Could you imagine that, by the way? It's just Paul. Where's Paul's defense lawyer? He doesn't have one. Where's Paul's legal team? Doesn't have one. He's got the Holy Spirit, which is pretty good. Pretty good advocate to have. But physically, he's all by himself and are surrounded by people who want to kill him, who want to rid him from the face of the earth. And they brought many serious charges against him, but they could not prove them. Verse 8, then Paul made his defense. I've done nothing wrong against the Jewish law or against the temple or against Caesar. Period. It's not like another long, flowery speech. You're just like, guys, I didn't do anything wrong against you, or against you. I'm innocent, period. Why? Is it because he's just had enough, because he's impatient? Well, there could be some of that, but I think that Paul is just resolved to not be distracted. To not be distracted by his circumstances, and instead he keeps his eyes focused forward to where God is leading him. He's basically like, I am done. I've answered questions before the people who need to hear them. It's all on the record. By the way, there was somebody in that room writing things down, keeping the records. They can go to the official records and say, yep, this is the testimony. So you get to verse 9, and Festus is like, what am I going to do? Well, wishing to do the Jews a favor, he said to Paul, well, are you willing to go up to Jerusalem and stand trial before me on all these charges? And Paul answered, well, I'm now standing before Caesar's court where I ought to be tried. This is the appropriate place in the legal system. This is the court. I've not done anything wrong to the Jews, as you yourself know very well. Again, there's public record over years that's been written down and recorded. If, verse 11, however, I'm guilty of doing anything deserving death, I don't refuse to die. Imagine that. Paul's goal is not to become a free man again. Paul wants to go to Rome. Why does he want to go to Rome? Because that's the center of the world at that point. And he knows if I'm in Rome, I'm going to have an opportunity to speak in front of these people and those people and those people, and those people are going to go to their places and they're going to spread this message, and that is going to accomplish the mission, the assignment that God has given to him. So he's like, I don't really care about my life. I just want to keep going on my assignment. But if the charges brought against me by these Jews are not true, no one has the right to hand me over to them. I appeal to Caesar. I appeal to Caesar, which as a Roman citizen was his legal right. He could make that request. So why does he say, I want to go to see Caesar? We talked about he wants to go to Rome, but the deal is that he just refuses to give energy to the distractions. Paul's like, man, I have been in courtroom after courtroom. I've told my story. Most of y'all don't want to hear it, so I'd rather go to somebody who has not heard my story yet, who's not heard the gospel yet. I'm focused in. I'm dialed in on what God has called me to do, and I don't want to have my focus be diluted or distracted. And so after Festus had conferred with his council in verse 12, he declared, you've appealed to Caesar you will go. Now, it's interesting that he said, it says after Festus had conferred with his council, he doesn't just say, well, you're a Roman citizen, you appealed to Caesar, you're granted that. He had to talk it through with them. Because he could have said, no, Paul, this is all you get. But remember, what did Jesus say to him? You will go to Rome. You are going to make it to Rome. And so Paul, leaning into what God has promised him, he says, I'm going to trust what God said to me. I'm going to put this out there, and we're going to go to Rome. So he gets his wish. And so Paul's resolve and his focus keeps him facing where God is leading him. He's got this focus. He's got this focus. And this word for us this morning is important because I think the Church of Jesus Christ, and I'll just say for myself personally, we are easily distracted. We're easily distracted by politics, we're easily distracted by celebrity. We put goals on the church that aren't necessarily God's goals for the church. There are personal vanity things like, oh, if the church was this, the church was that, then I would be excited. I'm confessing that I do that too. God wants us to focus in. What is our purpose? Our purpose is to make disciples, is to represent Christ. That's it. That is, scripturally speaking, our job. And we have to continually check in and say, am I leaning into that vision of representing Christ? And I've said before, you don't have to be a pastor to represent Christ. You can represent Christ wherever you are. You can go out to lunch after church today and represent Christ down at Portillo's or at Jewel. I always get I kind of wince a little bit sometimes when I see the cars with the fish, little metal fish on the back of them, and those are the ones that are the meanest drivers and tend to be the ones that like to use the one-finger gestures to people. Like, you're representing Christ. If you want to put that fish on the back of your car, you are representing Christ. So whatever you do, whatever you say, whatever gestures you make to the fellow motorists, well, that's representing Christ. So we do. Whether we want to or not, we represent Christ. So are we keeping our focus clear? And when I ask myself that question, it reminds me how much I need this cross. Which is why I think it's so apropos this morning that we conclude our service at the Lord's table. That we're reminded of what Jesus has done for us. That Jesus did go to the cross because he loves us. But before we participate and partake in the bread and the cup, I think it's important for us to take an inventory on where we are with the Lord, where we are in our relationship with God. Because I'm just going to be honest, none of us have got this down perfectly. I'm going to say that until I go to my eternal reward. I will say probably in my hospital room or wherever that final day is, I'm still working on it, and God's still working on me. So we come to this table as people desperately in need of God's grace, desperately in need of God's redemption. And as our practice here, we invite you to engage in this prayer of confession. And how we do it here is we're going to do this together, a couple lines at a time. And then you're going to, when you see the yellow font, that's an opportunity for you to participate. And then you're going to see a couple questions. Because we don't want to just buzz through a liturgy. We don't want to just say these words. But we want to invite you that this moment of communion, this moment around the bread and the cup, can be a moment of new life for us, of recharging, of refocusing. We can refocus our lives remembering that we need Jesus, that we need what Jesus did for us on the cross. So I want to invite you, as we start in this prayer of confession, to join in. This is your opportunity this morning. So most merciful God, we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. So I want to just invite you to take a few moments to reflect on how you have sinned against God and other people. What distracts you from loving God and other people? And we continue together. We have not loved you with our whole heart, and we have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. So take another few moments to reflect on how you've withheld love from God and from your neighbors. How do you keep your focus on being a blessing to others? So take a few moments to reflect on that. We continue once more. We are truly sorry and humbly repent for the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ. Have mercy on us and forgive us, that we might delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen. So finally, friends, take a moment to reflect on how you are representing Christ to others. How do you remind yourself to represent Christ well? Friends, I'd like to invite you to stand as we proclaim our faith together. So all around the world today, churches are saying the Apostles' Creed, many different languages. And so when we say the Apostles' Creed, it reminds us that Trinity Church is not just the only church in the world, but there are many churches following Jesus, believing the Scriptures, who are confessing their faith. So we join arms with them today. And we say, I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into Hades. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sits on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From then he shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You be seated once more. Friends, we're reminded by the Apostle Paul, the very one that we've been reading about. He writes in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood. Do this whenever you drink it in remembrance of me. For whenever you eat this bread or drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes." So Holy Spirit, we pray this morning that you would be at work in our hearts, in our lives, drawing us more closely to you, that we might represent you well, that we might keep our eyes focused on you, not on our situation, not on our circumstances, but on God. God, how you are at work. And God, we confess that is so hard to see. So often, Lord, we feel alone. We feel like it's just up to us. So would you remind us, Lord? Would you remind us of your love and your grace? Would you meet us this morning in this meal, that we might know you more deeply and that we might connect with our brothers and sisters gathered here today in a more significant way as well? We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So at Trinity, we practice open communion. That means that you don't have to be a member of this church. You don't have to be part of the Evangelical Covenant denomination. No, if you love Jesus, and if your heart is open to God's movement, to God's Spirit, then come. You are welcome to come participate. We're going to have some deacons on this side. I'm going to be on this side. You can go to either side. We'll serve you the bread and the cup. We ask you that you would take it, hold it, bring it back to your seat, and then we'll all partake together. So come, for all things have been made ready. That's for upstairs. Can you? She just ran up. Body of Christ broken for you, and the blood of Christ shed for you. Friends, this is the body of Christ, been broken for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Eat and remember what he's done for you. This is the blood of Christ, been poured out for you for the forgiveness of your sins. Drink, remember the love that he's shown you. So whenever we've heard the word proclaimed or shared in the table, we always want to respond in some way. And so this morning we respond in worship by singing He Leadeth Me. It's an old hymn, but the idea is that God is leading us and that we are invited to keep our eyes fixed on him. So I invite you to stand once more for our final hymn, He Leadeth Me. Friends, I just want to say before we receive the benediction that if you find yourself in that place where hope seems to have run out, I want to just invite you, encourage you, don't give up. Hang in there. Fix your eyes on Jesus. And if you have a hard time seeing how God is working, grab one of your brothers and sisters that you know knows the Lord and ask them to walk with you. That's why we have the church. We're not designed to do this solo. We are created to be in community, brothers and sisters together, that we encourage and we support each other. So with that in mind, friends, receive this benediction. Friends, may you represent Christ well. May you keep your eyes fixed on Jesus, and may you show each other the hope of Christ. Show the world the hope of Christ, that all may come to know him. Pray this in the powerful name of Jesus. Amen. Go in his power and peace.